another method. It says here, force is defined by its magnitude and two points on its line of action. It's not hard. There is a systematic process that we're going to develop and follow through. And you already know how to do this from 2D because I've done this with you. You may not be making that connection yet. So this is saying this, your original force F, and if you're writing this in your notes, you want to write like this. Your F is equal to its magnitude. It says force defined by its magnitude, right? Again, the original force is a vector, so you have to have the symbol on top. This is your F magnitude and defined by its two points on its line of action. But in general, we want to have our lambda. And in this particular method, our lambda, our direction vector, will be defined by two points on the line of action of the force, okay? So most of the work in the force resolution, especially with this method, will be associated with the direction, okay? So again, I'm taking this picture from your textbook. It's almost identical to it. So I have a force that is acting in space, F, right? And if I were to extend this line of action, and I just need to find two points, any two points on the line of action of the force. But if I'm going to, if there are multiple points and I have to choose only two, I want to make sure I choose two points where I know it's their information in terms of their position coordinates. So to make it easier, if you were to extend this line of action, what two points on its line of action do you guys see on this page?
M and N.
M and N. Okay. Your textbook uses these two points or these two letters, M and N. So I got these two points. And notice what we know about these two points. For points M, we know it's X, Y, Z coordinates. For N, likewise, we know its position coordinates, X, Y, and Z. But notice the sense of the original force. It's moving from point M towards point N, right? So when we define this line, when we define this direction, I think I have it. All right, it's on the next slide, but let's do it here. We're starting from point M and we're going towards point N. So you have the initial point going towards the final point. Okay, and we're going to define the distance between these two points by using a vector that connects these two points. So notice I put a vector symbol on top of the two letters of M and N. And what else do we want to find? The actual distance, the magnitude. Of this vector. So those two things will help us to define the direction of this force. Okay, so I'm going to come back to this. So don't worry. If you think that I'm not allowing you guys to write things down here. Okay, so I just want to quickly go here. This is our method two. Your textbook doesn't call it a method two, but it really is our method two here. First step, we're going to first identify two points on the line of action of the force. In this example, these two points were our M and N. And we're going to find the distance in terms of X, Y, and Z between these two points. So your M, N is a vector, will be defined by the distance in the X, distance between these two points in the Y, and the distance between these two points in the Z axis. Okay. Then we're going to take the magnitude of the distance. So your MN is your distance. And how do we find the distance? And I have these in the notes below, but I want to make sure you guys understand where I'm going with this. We're going to take the square root of the individual components of the distance. Okay. And then we're going to put everything together to find your direction, which is your lambda. So there are multiple steps to be taken, but the steps are very, very systematic. And we're going to do one by one, and I will come back to, you know, these two steps again and again. Okay. I already have these down here somewhere. Yeah, I got it down here. It's the same thing. I have them all written down here for you. Okay. But I said to you before, you already know how to do this. So let me use this blank space here to tell you what I mean by that. In 2D, let me lay this flat because my writing is not good when I have it vertically. So here is your X and Y. And let's say that I gave you a force, F. And typically you would then say, well, the force F is defined by its angle of inclination. And let's say that we do have the angle of inclination, right? And then you would say, well, the F sub X is equal to the magnitude of the original force times cosine of theta sub X. And F sub Y would be F times sine of theta sub X, right? Easy peasy now, right? But without giving you the angle of inclination, sometimes I give you this, right? And I may have given you the distance in X and distance in Y. Then what did you do? Well, you have a right triangle, and I know what Bobby would say. Well, can I use the tangent and relate these two sides and find the angle of inclination? And I said, that's perfectly fine. But I said, I also want you guys to do a different way. So if I got X and Y, right? I don't want to use Z here, but you got X squared plus Y squared giving you, let's say, H squared. That is the side of your hypotenuse, right? Okay. And instead of writing it as cosine theta sub X and sine theta sub X, you would have written instead F times something else in the parentheses. For the X component, what would you have written? What is a fraction? You got the adjacent side over the hypotenuse, right? For the Y component, it would be Y over the hypotenuse. Okay, guess what we are doing in 3D? This is what we're gonna have to do in 3D. And that's why I was trying to prepare you guys for this, because I knew you guys are gonna have to do it. So in 2D, where are the 2 points? Well, we were not given exactly 2 points, but we were basically using this, right? That's why we had X and Y. And how do we get the hypotenuse? X squared plus Y squared and take the square root. That's exactly the same as what you have up here. Okay, resolving that vector into X, Y, and Z components, taking the squares and adding them up, taking the square root gives you the hypotenuse or the distance D. That's exactly the same method as in 2D. So I want you guys to be able to make this connection between 2D to 3D. It's just one more dimension, but the work is exactly the same. Okay. Now we're going to put everything together. Now, if you're taking notes, since you cannot bold it, this is what it looks like if you're writing it in your notes. Original force F, which is a vector defined by its magnitude and its direction vector, lambda, where we're going to replace our lambda by 2 points on the line of action, which is a vector, divided by its magnitude. Okay. I'm running out of space here, but your MN in terms of its components, like X and Y, like I have up here for your 2D, right? This is really your D sub X. This is your D sub Y. The distance in the X direction, distance in the Y. It's exactly the same thing. So you have the distance between the two points in the X, distance between the two points in the Y, and the distance between the two points in the Z. That's why you have D sub XI plus D sub YJ plus D sub ZK. Then divided by the actual distance, the magnitude between the two points. Okay. So in 2D, if I were to kind of borrow the 2D here, my 2D would have been F sub X plus F sub YJ. Okay, that is in 2D, the problem that I just did above. That's exactly the same thing. Okay, so individually in 3D, again, I have that in writing, but if you're writing, taking notes, remember to use this symbol for the vector, right, on top of the letters, okay? So individually, you got F sub X equal to the magnitude of the original force times the distance in the X divided by D. So this was like in 2D for me. This is what I had in 2D. For the Y, again, so you guys can make the relationship between 2D and 3D. This is what I had, okay? So again, the magnitude of the original force, distance between the two points in the Y, divided by the actual distance between the two points. I think it may look intimidating because of all these different letters going on, but mathematically, if this method is not hard. I actually find this method to be easier than method one. And I'm gonna show you how easy it is, okay? So if you are not digesting everything right now, it's okay. Just understand what these individual letters represent. At least that's what I would expect from you guys at this point. Okay, so let me show you this in action. But before that, look at the three angles of inclination. Again, we got the inverse cosine, but proportionally, these are all the same. So we can use the actual distance between the two points. So instead of having F sub X over F, we got D sub X over D, because proportionally, these are exactly the same. So there's not much to discuss over here, because these are making reference back to what we know, which is this. Again, there's a lot of repetition in this class. But I want to really show you this. Okay, let's do this one example problem. Again, this would be a good problem for a quiz type because it's short. So again, when students look at a picture like this, they get a little overwhelmed because they haven't seen too many things in 3D. But again, I promise you, it won't be so bad. So here is a frame. They use the term frame when the forces are considered to be multiple forces. And you don't have to know that for this chapter. We'll talk about frames in chapter 6, so we have a way to go. But it just means it's just a structure, okay? So this particular frame, ABC, it's right over here, ABC. Oh, what happened to my pen? ABC, okay? It's supported in part by cable D, B, and E. So if you look at this cable right here, it's one long continuous cable that seems to go around this ring at B and then gets supported on the wall at E. So it wraps around the ring at B. So it's just one continuous cable. Knowing that tension in the cable is 385 newtons. So when it says tension in the cable, meaning just this one cable, right? This cable, the tension is 385 newtons. That means this is your magnitude. The magnitude of the force in this cable is equal to 385. Maybe I should write it as TBE. Let me rewrite this because they said cable T, no T, oh God, I gotta erase this. DBE, right? DBE. So the magnitude of the force in this cable is equal to 385 newtons. So if you're thinking ahead to the force defined by its magnitude and its direction, I already know its magnitude, okay? That's already been provided to us. Determine the components of the force exerted by the cable on the support at D. Okay, this is where students are likely to make mistakes. So hang on tight here and pay attention to this statement. So basically it's saying that find X, Y, Z, right? F sub X, F sub Y, and F sub C. These are your rectangular components of the force exerted by the cable on the support at D. Okay, notice that I got a cable right here, D, B, E, and I know its magnitude, but it says the force exerted by the support at D. This is my D. Now, why is that important? I'm going to ask you this. So of the cable is D, B, and E, but it's asking us to analyze only one segment of the cable. And how do I know that? Because it's distinguishing point D. It doesn't say at E, it says at D. So for now, we're going to ignore this segment of the cable. Okay, so we can actually break this down into two segments. Remember the homework problem where we had a sailor being rescued and we had a cable, I think it was ACB, and we had one section in the first quadrant, another section in the second quadrant. It's kind of like that problem, okay? But the magnitude of the force in this cable does not change. It still remains at 385 newtons. But of the two segments of this cable, we just want to focus on this first one between D and B. So here's my question. So if I'm looking at only B and D, which of the two points is my initial point and my final point? That is, if I were to extend the line of action of this force, it passes through, it's got to pass through at least two points. And I hope you guys can see the two points here, D and B, right? So those are gonna be my two points on the line of action of this force. So the question is, do I write it as D, B, or do I write B, D? Which one? And this is where students are likely to make mistakes. If this is wrong, everything that follows from it is wrong. So here is how we're going to do it. It says exerted at D. The point of exertion is always going to be your initial point. So the sense of the force will go from point D towards point F, B, and the sense of the force will be going towards point B. And so I'm going to call this T sub DB. And the magnitude of this force is 385 newtons. So here, what I'm trying to say is this. Your DB is not the same as BD. And your problem will always tell you the point of exertion. It will always start state that for you. If it doesn't, then we cannot know which is the right one. Okay. I have a bigger picture here that I'm going to write all over again. So again, let me redraw my line of action. I see 2 points here at B and D. This is your point of exertion. My initial point. Therefore, my force has to be pointing away from point D, going towards point B. And I'm going to call this T sub DB with a magnitude of 385 newtons. I'm going to come back to this picture, but I want to write something down here. So we got, this is what we are using, this format. Let's apply this to our particular problem. We're calling our force T sub DB because it starts from point D going towards point B, defined by its magnitude, T sub DB, which is 385 newtons. And I do not know its direction yet, but I'm going to use 2 points on this line of action. So I'm going to use a subscript notation of DB to indicate that. And then I'm going to further explain what the lambda vector is equivalent to. So again, the magnitude of the force. And this time I'm going to replace my lambda with 2 points, DB. And I'm going to divide my component of that vector by its magnitude. So we're going to rewrite it like that. So now our goal is, we have this 385 newtons. We need to find this. And once we have that, we can find the magnitude. Okay. So I want to ask you, for these 2 points, what are the coordinates of these 2 points? Take a look at point D. No angles, all you got is some measurement, right? Distances between points, points to XYZ axes. So where exactly is point D? Meaning what is its position coordinate? I don't care which one, XYZ, start somewhere. What is zero? X is zero?
All of them are zero.
Point D is here. It's on the wall. So if you look at it, its height is what? Maybe that's easier to see first.
Well, it X is negative 280.
No.
Oh.
That's your Z. Can you guys see the height of 510?
Oh, yeah.
Okay, that might be the easiest one to see first.
Oh, okay.
So I got 510 here, right? But let's take a look at Z. Someone mentioned 280. Your Z right here of 280 is parallel to which of the three axes? Is it parallel to X? Is it parallel to Y? Or is it parallel to Z?
Z.
Z. So that is your Z component. Okay. Is it positive or negative?
Positive.
Good. So that's positive 280. Oh, I got to squeeze that in. But what is your X?
Zero.
Very good. X is zero. Very good. There is no measurement or no distance parallel to X for the point D. Then let's move on to your point B right here on this frame. Let's start with the easy one. What is its height?
Zero.
Zero. Good. Can you guys see your X? What distance is parallel to X?
480.
480. Good. What about in Z?
600.
600. Very good. Okay. So technically, this is what we are doing here. So I'm going to go back to those points, and I hope you guys are writing those things down too. Okay. So even though we got this equation, let's do one at a time. So start with the vector between the 2 points defined by D and B. So mathematically, this is what we are looking for. Your D sub X I, D sub Y J, and D sub Z in K. Individually, D sub X meaning final point minus the initial point, right? So between D and B, again, which is our final point?
B.
B, very good. So you got B in terms of its X coordinate minus D sub X. And we're going to do it for the rest. So we're taking these two points and we're going to take the difference between these two points in all three dimensions, X, Y, and Z. So if you have these coordinates already identified, then you just take the difference between the two, right? So B sub X is 480. So I got 480 minus zero. I, without the I, I don't know if this difference is in X, Y, or Z. So I need to have my unit vector. My B sub Y is zero. D sub Y is 510. My B sub C is equal to 600 minus D sub C of 280 times K. So I get for the line vector DB in terms of its rectangular components, because that's what they are, rectangular components, I got 480 I minus 510 J plus 320 K, and these are all measured in millimeters. Okay, so we got our two points on the line of action of the force. We took the distance between the two points in all three dimensions. Did I lose anybody over here? Got our numerator checked. Let's find our denominator, which is the actual distance between the two points. That's our magnitude. So I got D sub X squared plus D sub Y squared, D sub C squared. So I got 480 squared, 510 squared, plus 320 squared, and the distance that we get, again, in the formula, I had the lowercase d for distance, and we get 770 millimeters. Again, in 2D, that's like finding the hypotenuse of the right triangle. Okay, so for my lambda, my direction vector, I found my line vector, then I found this actual distance. So I got everything checked off for lambda. Only thing we gotta do now is to put everything together. Okay, let me scroll down a bit. So again, let me rewrite our T sub dB, that's the name of our force, defined by its magnitude and its direction, defined by its lambda. And then lambda is further defined by two points on the line of action of the force and its magnitude. Our magnitude is 385 newtons. And my dB, I found it over here, right up here, 480 I minus 510 J plus 320 K. In millimeters divided by magnitude of 770 millimeters. Millimeters are canceled out. Now I need to state my component. Okay, mathematically, what are you doing here? You're going to 385 newtons times 480 divided by 770, right? So you got 385 newtons times 480i divided by 770. That is your x component. I'm going to do it for this one, but I want to be doing this in the future problems.
Couldn't you add up 4i minus 510j plus 20k just as it is, or do you have to break it up?
Oh, you have to break it. Why do you have to break it up? They're x, y, z. You cannot add x and y. You cannot just add the magnitudes, right? Because they're vectors. They have their directions. So you cannot just take 480 minus 10 plus 320. You can't do that. Absolutely not. You have to individually. I have to squeeze that last piece in there. Okay, so it's x component, 385 times 480 divided by 770. We get 240i. Notice that y component is negative. So I got 385 times 10 divided by 770, or negative 255j. Finally, for your z component, 385, 320 divided by 770, get positive 160k, and the unit is in newtons. Now, fortunately for us, this problem was just asking for the rectangular component. So this is your t sub db in dx, t sub db y component, and this is your z component of the force. But I need to state my answers using correct significant figures. 240 is not in 3, so I need to make it into 3 significant figures by putting a dot, and 160 needs to be in 4, so decimal point, and add another 0. That's it. Even though it seems like many steps, this actually is easier than the first method. Let me know when you guys are done. Well, I guess you cannot really tell me, but I'm just gonna use Bobby as my baseline here because I can see Bobby on the screen. So Bobby, you're done writing? Okay, good. To me, this is quite a lengthy process. Even though it's very systematic, we did one by one, right? But I want to actually make this a little easier for you guys. So I want to show you a little trick. But mathematically, this is all fine and dandy. But this first step right here, to me, was taking a bit too long, this step. Where is it? This was taking way too long for me. Imagine if you got 4 forces to resolve, and you are going to have 4 forces eventually. This would be taking way too long, right? So we want to find a quicker and easier way to do it. So for the time that I have, I want to show you a little trick. I want to go back to my original picture right here. And instead of taking the position coordinates of D and B, I'm just going to forget about these. But what is important is the order. So I am going from D to B. That is absolutely essential. Again, this is not the same as BD. But if you gave me BD because alphabetically that sounds better, the entire work would be wrong. Okay, so be careful with that. This is really important. I want to do this graphically, and I'd rather have you guys do this graphically rather than to take the difference between the two points. So again, where is our starting point? What's our starting point?
D.
D. We're going from point D. Our final destination is point B. Since we're in 3D, we can only move in X, Y, Z. Not in that order, but we can only move right along the 3 axes of X, Y, and Z, or parallel to them. So I'm gonna start from point D, and I am going to move straight down parallel to Y. This is my D sub Y. How much did I just move in D sub Y?
Negative 510.
Very good. It's parallel to this, right? Very good. So I'm moving down. But am I at point B? Absolutely not. I moved in Y. That means I got X and Z available. So from here, since I landed on the Z axis, so I'm just going to move right along the Z and I'm going to move towards point A. And that takes me to point A. How much did I just move in Z? Did I move the entire distance of 600 millimeters?
No.
I did not. So from A to right over here, the total is 600. Right? But from point D to here is 280. So what is this difference right here? That is your 320. Okay? Then from point A, I need to go to point B. So this time I'm going to move. I've already moved in Y and Z. I only got X. I'm going to move parallel to X. And it takes me to point B. I'm right there. And how much did I just move in X?
480.
Positive or negative?
Positive.
Very good. So putting it all together, you got 480. Well, dB is equal to 480i minus 510j plus 320k. You don't have to show all that other work. Unless you want to, you can, until you get comfortable with the graphical method, but you do not have to. Which one do you think was shorter and easier to do? What do you think?
That one, the second one?
The second one, I think so. It's so much easier. And even if you use this long mathematical method, I want you guys to double check your work by doing it graphically. This is what I would prefer that you guys do because it's so much easier, it's quicker. And it's almost like foolproof, okay? Because as you guys are moving, you guys have these arrowheads, right? Telling you whether these are positive or negative. The only thing that I do worry about is this. Because I moved first in the Y, students may write 510i. That's what I worry about. So when you do it this way, I would probably leave it spaces and then fill it in as you go along. And then we did the X last, right? I think that might be a little easier. And then double check again. Because if this is wrong, your distance will be wrong, right? If that is wrong, this entire lambda is wrong and your force resolution is completely wrong. And you want to prevent making mistakes here. Okay, any questions on this? Did I lose anybody? Are we still here? All I see is Bobby and there's Jason and Dylene. Any questions? Okay. I know I'm out of time, so when we come back, we're gonna do a couple of homework problems from last week. And see over here, again, you got two angles being provided and you have to find the missing angle here. And the Y component again is negative. So you can actually do this on your own if you like, because the solution keys are posted, but if not, we'll do this problem again quickly in class. And this is the one that typically students have trouble with. The second homework problem that I got here. And we'll do this together. I think it's the picture that makes it confusing for the students. So we'll do this one together and then we'll use our methods to find the resultant force. And then the last topic in chapter 2 is equilibrium in 3D, which will not take too long for us to do. Okay, so I guess I'll let you guys go like a few seconds early today, unless there are questions. So I'll see you guys, what's today? Today's Wednesday already? Oh, okay, I'll see you guys on Monday. The class is too short for me. Unless you got questions, you guys can stay. If not, maybe I should show my face. I'm thinking that I got my face there. So I'll see you guys Monday. Have a great weekend. And